Today, we are very fortunate to have Andrew Walk with us. Andrew, who seems, from our conversation at lunch, and if you read his bio, to have touched this whole area of, as we were talking about it at lunch, social innovation in a bunch of different ways, not only clearly through education and introducing very early on courses in this field, but also in terms of interacting with government and trying to, on a larger macro-social level, begin to talk with people about how do we set a stage, how do we create an environment that is more conducive to social enterprise, and what are the sort of factors or conditions or things that we want to be putting in place as a society in order to foster more social innovation, in order to foster the creation, the emergence of these sorts of organizations. So Andrew's going to talk a little bit today about root cause, and then I think talk about a little bit about social enterprise in general, and then open it up to your questions. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, and I want good questions today.
Hi, everyone. How are you all?
You can talk.
It'll be a little loud. Hi, everyone. How are you all today? Good. Let me tell you how I'm going to frame this, is I have to say, I don't know if you knew, but I got this list of questions that you all came up with. And if I answered all these, I'd probably be here for like 10 hours. But I was incredibly amazed at how thoughtful they were. So I think I'm going to frame today, knowing that we have until 2:30, is I'm going to tell you just very briefly about how I came into this work, so you get just some sort of sense from a personal and professional perspective what drove me to this point. I'm going to share with you a PowerPoint presentation that I gave to Atlantic Philanthropy's program officers in the U.S. aging and disadvantaged youth area, January of 2000, I should say 9, by the way. But this presentation, or a portion of it, was given in January of 2009. Is that right? What year are we? 2008, let me take that back, 2008, which was sort of where root cause was at that point in time. I think after that, that'll give you an idea of some of the things you brought up, like what is our business model, how do our different units operate, things like that. And then I'm going to open up the questions and let you sort of drive the dialogue for a little while. And then I'm going to share with you, Atlantic then, based on that meeting, gave us a planning grant to sort of put our own business planning process on ourselves. And I'm going to share with you what emerged is what we call Root Cause 2.0, which is sort of where we're now going. A couple of you talked about theory of change, so it's in our model of theory of change overall, so it gives you a sense of where we're going. Certainly not where we're at, but where our future is. I'll hope to try to put that out to you with some time to ask some questions as well, and I'll try to monitor it overall. So that's how I think we're going to set things up. So let me just briefly tell you, just personally and professionally, just a little bit about myself, and we'll stop and just see if anyone has any questions related to those particular things. On the personal side, there are sort of three things that I think are pretty important that I sort of have thought about as I've thought about my drive for this work. The first was my grandfather was a councilman. He was a councilman in Pittsburgh for like 25 plus years. And he was extremely innovative in the way that he brought a variety of different changes to that city. He was the first founder of smog control in the United States, practicing that in Pittsburgh. It sort of makes sense, right? Steel, things like that. So you can sort of see the impacts of that happening pretty quickly in a place like that. He also founded the School of Public Health at Carnegie Mellon, and was extremely active in bringing about a lot of innovations in bringing arts and culture to Pittsburgh, which both drove new businesses and citizens there, as well as kept a certain citizen base there. And it was his sort of drive for public service that was a pretty unique impact on my life and watching, speaking to him before he died about his work. My father was a three-decade successful Wall Street executive. He was at Bear Stearns, which no longer exists. He wasn't there when all of the fallout happened overall. But he was certainly a maverick in business. He was highly innovative in what perhaps some people call the drive for some of our problem very early stages where there were no derivatives, for those of you know, but just option trading. He was highly innovative in that overall. He went to HBS and had a very successful career. And the third piece is that I was a for-profit entrepreneur. And it was during that time where I had started a business. It was this multi-restaurant delivery service in Connecticut. And I started to recognize that this business that was employing people had this amazing opportunity to create some real change. And it was that point that I started to think that, those two worlds, my father's and my grandfather's, were really driving me towards how do those two worlds come together in some particular way. And that there was the passion for social change and creating impact and changing people's lives with some of the rigor around business, and not because business was actually had all the answers, but that we as a society, because of how we had valued business, had really learned how to scale certain types of services and products that people wanted because they were willing to pay money for it. And so that drove investment in business schools, it drove investment in education for business people, executive ed, professional development, so on and so forth. So a lot of the sort of money that went into business sort of drive the whole understanding of how businesses could thrive overall. And those two worlds were really coming together to me as I was working in this business. I did a couple of things at that time that I found to be interesting to me. It started while I had this business, a mortgage program where anyone who was in the business actually, that we would help them to get mortgages. So in their time while they were at work, we would get the paperwork, help them understand how to fill them out, so on and so forth. And it was just something that we did just as a way to sort of recognize how we might be able to give back. The second thing was because most of the people who worked at the business were people who had other jobs. We gave them training on computer programs, on the computers we had when they were idle in their work, that they could take back skill sets to get raises at their jobs. Neither one was either unique or, you know, that impactful overall, but it was starting to think about this intersection between business and social change. So that led me to sell the business and go back to business school. Oddly, to start a business, sell a business, and go back to business school, they sound sort of odd. But I went back and I got a nonprofit management and entrepreneurship degree at BU. But right before I did that was really where the big change in terms of where I thought that I might be able to make impact was. I was volunteering in New York City at something called the Voluntary Action Center. What they do is, I don't know if they're around anymore. People come in the door, they say, I'd like to volunteer. My job was, as an unpaid intern, was to say, what do you like to do? What would you like to volunteer to do? They would say, I really like animals. And I would say, okay, well, let me go into my database. And that would spit out, you know, ASPCA, located in New York, they're looking for a volunteer. I'd print out a piece of paper, I'd hand it to them, they'd walk out the door. This was a $3 million line item in the Giuliani budget at the time, and they would then send their numbers that would say how many people that they saw by people like me. So I asked the person who was running this part of, I forget what the partner was in, if they had any idea what happened once the people left. And they said, no, we have no idea what happened to them. You know, we get counted by the number of people that come to work, or we can this piece of paper. So I asked them if they wouldn't mind, and I found out. So I spent my summer studying a subset of what happened to them, and I found out that that they only actually matched, not retained by the way, just matched 3% of the people that walked through the door over a 3-month period overall. So that 50%, something like, of the inquiries didn't exist in the database when they made the call. Of the ones that made the call, they never got a follow up. Of the ones that made a follow up, they actually didn't have an opportunity. And I went and I said, gave this information to the person running the agency, and she buried it. She had no interest whatsoever. And that opened up my eyes to say that the sort of money that was going in and impact that was going out had a complete disconnect for me. That I had had to, in my business, put a business plan together, show very particular returns. If I got returns, I was actually able to get some set of guarantee of people who would want to work for me, get money that could be capitalized for my business. And there was this whole world out there. At that point, I was thinking it was in the nonprofit sector that was sort of operating, at least from my perspective, and could be challenged on this, without a level of rigor that matched the resource flow that was going on right at that time. Right now, little did I know that nonprofits at that time and to this day are growing at an alarming rate. The amount of money that was going into them was growing at an alarming rate. And I found that there was this intersection between, I would say, my natural inclination towards a business mindset with also an inclination to social impact overall. So I founded Root Cause. Our vision, when we formed it then, holds true through our planning process. Everything else in that next PowerPoint I'll show you is new. But this vision is still true. And there's a lot of important pieces in here I want to sort of throw out at you, because some of them will begin to answer some of your questions about, like, why are you different than Ashoka? Or what's your model for change and stuff like that. So let me tease it apart for a moment here. I'll just read it, and then I want to tease apart three different parts, which I think are pretty clear. So we envision a world in which the public, private, and nonprofit sectors work together to invest and reinvest in the most efficient, effective, and sustainable solutions to social problems. So the three parts that I'm going to tease out here just very quickly for you are the public, private, and nonprofit sectors work together. So I think right now those sectors operate in silos. They clearly have different intentions. They're not actually working very well together. And I think that a very important way in which to drive to the ability for sustainable solutions is a much more clear idea of both what their roles are individually and what their roles are collectively overall. The second, which is probably of particular importance to me, is this concept of invest and reinvest overall. And what that means is that if we're going to invest in something that deals with a social issue, and it's making any progress that it said it's going to make based on some agreed upon what is progress, we should reinvest it. And that the beauty of the private sector organizational form is that it has two things it can rely on that so far up until now, whether government or nonprofit, it doesn't matter who creates some sort of model for a solution, doesn't have. Either positive cash flow, which allows you to reinvest in growth and research and development, right? So I make a pen for 5 cents and I sell it for 10 cents, and now I've got 5 cents left over to do something with. Right? Whether I give bonuses to incentivize my people, or R&D to make a better pen, or use it to build a new pen factory. And secondly, a very, very predictable marketplace for getting capital. Until the sort of debt credit crunch, it's pretty clear that you can start a business and you build it along a certain way, and you can go to friends and family, you can go to banks, you can go to private investors, you can go to the IPM firm. And what doesn't happen right now, and why you need an invest and reinvest mentality, is if you do well in a particular social issue, there are so many ways that that thing will go away. I was out to dinner last week, and someone was talking about this amazing recidivism program that had social science-based research of why it worked that is completely gone. And that's just a rare thing that you would not see. You know, businesses that do well drive investment overall. And unless we have this mentality of invest and reinvest, we won't get there. And then the third is this idea around efficiency, effectiveness, and sustainability overall. Efficiency being that it's using the best use of the resources. Effectiveness being that we actually understand and it's being effective in the impact or change it's trying to make. And sustainability has some sort of models around how it's going to drive sustainability. I know someone asked about sustainability in one of your questions. So this is the vision that we set out. Root Cause was formed in February of 2004, so just a little less than 5 years ago overall. Our values at the organization, which I think are important just quickly to understand, because they do drive how we operate today, is that most importantly is we focus on the social problem. And we do that regardless of organizational structure, ego, or political agenda, which we think can often get away of just focusing on what the problem is overall. We believe that broad range of perspectives is critical. that you need to integrate practice as well as applied research and public policy into your thinking, that you take entrepreneurial approaches with a thought around ongoing self-improvement, and that we're very interested, if possible, to collaborate with what we believe will be emerging of new as well as existing systems and institutions that start to build, you know, a more rigorous marketplace for driving social change of some sort. So how did I think that we could start to get there? Well, you know, on the outside looking in, and actually for myself as well, Root Cause is just a series of highly fragmented initiatives that I think look the same today on our website as they will when we see this presentation. And whether it's a method to this madness or not, I don't know. The one I'll show you later is our attempt to create some more synergy around it overall. But the primary driver was we needed a solid consulting practice, a la Bridgespan or McKinsey, but without McKinsey's brand or Bain's support, to give us a business model to get that cash flow that we would need to build out the larger vision overall. So most of our energy and resources has been built around building this consulting practice overall. We provide strategic organizational development for innovative, results-oriented organizations whose primary mission is social impact. And I'm just going to drive through these pretty quickly and give you just a little bit of an idea. You know, our sweet spot is around this full business plan, which some of you may see on the website. We have a book out on our methodology that you can download free overall. It's primarily been what our bread and butter has been. But we do have subsets. We found that we're doing a lot more post-plan work and implementation overall. But our big break, because we weren't Bain and we weren't McKinsey, was there was a woman who was in her early 60s named Kathy Freund. And I had gone from leaving business school to sort of anyone who was interested to sort of practice this business planning methodology that said, we have a business plan for money, do we have a business plan for how to solve a social problem? First did it for volunteer work, then I did it with small contracts. And this woman had gone to Atlantic Philanthropies and said, I want you to give me $2 million to help me scale my innovation in Portland, Maine for technology. And they said, no, we'll give you some money for a business plan, and here's a few names, including Bridgespan. She got my name from a small engagement we were doing also in Portland, Maine. I think she liked the fact that I had her meet me in a coffee shop. My price was a lot cheaper than the others, and I just started at MIT. So she hired us. I had one person working for us at the time. And basically, we just threw the kitchen sink at her. Everything I had learned, we just put it in, and we said, we're going to write, you know, the world-class business plan that you could ever imagine overall. And Atlanta got that business plan, and they had $240,000 senior transportation organization dealing with that issue in Portland. Atlantic put $3.2 million into the organization. And since that day until the recession, we have not needed work. We've been trying to figure out how to handle work, how to build quality control systems, so on and so forth, so that we sort of drive this work around this methodology of this business plan that we do with primarily Atlantic and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, with some work here and there with other foundations like Wallace, but haven't until recently branched out because, quite honestly, we're trying to figure out how to do this with more just me and a couple of other people. We have, I think, 19 or 20 consultants now that are full-time, like, independent overall. A couple of unique aspects of our work are we developed something called the social impact model, which was I was completely perplexed by some people wanted you to use what's called a logic model, which you may or may not have heard of, which is this logical chain of events. And then some people would throw out this term theory of change, which I never really found anyone that could tell me what the definition of the theory of change is. Arrows moving around.
That was not in the contract.
You know, so we took the bold move that while now we have to brand something and maybe we're confusing it, but we needed a way to go in with people that wanted us to do logic model and theory of change and sort of spoke a language to give them something concrete to think about. So So we came up with this thing that said that for an organization really need to define what their problem is, and that problem you should connect to their mission. And that mission then would have some sort of model that they would work with and the strategies that would get them there. And that would then flow to how they would do measurement, and that measurement would lead towards some vision. So we've got some combination of a vision. Now you're going to see this for Root Cause 2.0 later, so in itself. We didn't have one of these, by the way. I'm not sure the one we have right now is the right one, but it's a good shot at the overall. So that was one part that we were finding in our work that was very grounding to the organizations we worked with. They found the practicality of it extremely valuable, while we also gave them some sort of theory of how they were going to change. And the last piece was, we believe very much in feedback loops, which are a strong part of business, that evaluation in business is not for the external environment, it's actually really for the internal environment to make course corrections. So we very much believe that there was a data opportunity here to the data from the models sort of fed into the indicators, and that gave a feedback loop, and then you would make constant course corrections overall. So that was an important part of it as well. The second part that we brought, and I'll just put them up here, was that we were very much action-oriented in the way we thought about everything. We didn't believe that you could go in to nonprofit organizations that oftentimes were small and under-resourced and spend 3 months to do a lot of analysis given this strategy and then go. And you had to be very action-oriented overall. So our analysis went to strategy and then went to action. All of our work comes with coaching. So we directly coach the senior leadership throughout the work itself. So there's executive coaching that comes with it. And we're providing implementation support ongoing. We also add to it something we call action while planning, which is during engagements we actually pick isolated things that are going on here and now in the organization and help them act on it, both to keep the organization moving forward as well as to inform the business planning process overall. So an example we're right now doing of the business plan for the National Alliance for Public Charter Schools. So it's a pretty this is the sort of the organization that's holding, quite honestly, the charter school movement that stands right now. And they just let go of a COO and they had a search going on, and we felt that searching for a COO while we're in the middle of this deep planning process was not a great idea. So in action while planning, we sort of sat with them and really thought about what the alternatives would, and came to the conclusion that someone that was in the CFO role they could actually promote. We find that to be pretty unusual to move from strategy to sort of day-to-day help with sort of HR, so that's another piece. As I've said from the earlier part, you know, we believe that our engagements, the process of business planning is really to give us the opportunity to do strategy, organizational leadership development. We do bring everything with a business lens, there's just no doubt about that. So organizations that are not comfortable with that are probably not a good fit. And then lastly, our engagements for this particular service are very long. The average engagement of some of the people that we, I guess you could say, compete with or colleagues are much shorter, they're 3 or 4 months. Ours is more of a facilitative process. We're more bringing them along in where they want to go as opposed to handing them off the answer, which we found actually wasn't overall. This is only through 07, because we haven't updated iTunes, but at that point, we had about 40 clients, 34 nonprofits, 6 government agencies. We had done a total of about 53 engagements because we started to do a lot of follow-on work overall. The average engagement was 8.6 months. Worked in a whole variety of different issue areas. We don't say, although we certainly have begun to build expertise in aging and education, we don't say we're experts in a particular area because we actually believe that the expertise we bring is the models, the tools, the rigor. And we think they know a lot more than we'll ever know. So we worked on an issue around home health care and Medicaid. And, you know, it would take 10 years to understand the Medicaid system overall. Percentage of clients are implementing work, which is one of 2 gauges that we've started to measure. We think if you're not using our work at the end of engagement, it's not very valuable if it just sits in the drawer. And we also believe that they should raise resources off our work. So our work has raised quite a bit of resources, not unlike a business plan in the private sector should raise resources. We think of it in a very sort of similar way overall. So I'm going to talk very quickly about what I had always considered to be, until Blue Cross 2.0 sort of this learning lab aspect of our work overall, because we have these other things that we work on, although not always coherent how they all fit together. So let me just quickly talk about each of those, and then I will open up to questions for you all. So we have, besides this consulting, these other areas, if you go on our website, when we do that, I'm going to just talk very quickly about. So what we thought was maybe it was sort of a learning lab for our consulting practice overall. So we have this venture forum that we've run now for 6 years in Boston called the Social Innovation Forum. It was started, quite honestly, for two reasons. It was started at the same time as Blue Cross overall in consulting practice. One was, frankly, a lost leader. So could we provide our free consulting practices locally to give us proof of point that we were actually doing work with someone? So that was one reason we did it. It was purely strategic marketing. But the second was we felt that there was a different way that resources could flow, and that funders could come together with nonprofits in a way like they hadn't before. And interestingly enough, early in class we were talking about Dutch Leonard, who just came to one of our sessions, who was sort of blown away at how this works, because it's a very different model than how funds flow right now, where we pick innovators in Boston, we give them free consulting and other services, and then we sort of open them up to the funding community we've built in a real trustful atmosphere that's very, very unique, where funders feel more comfortable to talk with these organizations overall. This has been our first and most important foray into this intersection between innovation and investment, which is where you're going to see is where our next evolution is going. So I said it gives 1 year consulting and training program for early stage social innovators, and it links local philanthropic network with yearly venture forum and ongoing events overall. Inner city entrepreneurs, which is the one thing on this list that's actually going to officially be spinning out of the cause legally in 3 weeks, was my attempt, because I had been doing work in small business development, to actually practice a practical solution to a social problem inside Root Cause to deliberately learn what I was trying to consult for. It's a small business development program. It's a 9-month peer-to-peer learning program. It links this volunteer network together. It's grown tremendously, quite honestly. It's only four years since it launched. It was selected by the SBA 14 months ago, and is now in 13 cities around the country. And it just drove in a particular niche in the small business economic development. But it really taught us a lot that we brought back to consulting. This is a new initiative of ours that I'm happy to say the Hewlett Foundation just awarded us $300,000 after 2.5 years of this work. It's aggregating and analyzing and disseminating actionable information to make better informed philanthropic choices. An easier way to say that is, what would it look like to have an impact research industry for social problems? We have it for picking winners in the private sector. There are places like Yankee Group and Gartner Group that produce public research reports that drive investment. What would it look like to produce reports that were easy to use and understand that can drive investment?
So do you do analyst calls?
We hope. That's right. We hope. This is now called Public Innovators. It bores out of the work that I think a lot of you have read about, which is strengthening and solidifying the collaboration between social innovation and government. This is the newest piece of our work. It really got launched in April when the Aspen paper came out. Our strategy there, which I can dig into deeper if people want to ask questions, is one of both public dissemination of activities that go around, the highlighting of great government leaders who are embracing this kind of thinking, and then we are on the ground at the city and state level working with some cities and states to actually institutionalize this work overall. And then our publishing aspect, which is sharing practical how-to knowledge and case studies, and then we started to branch out and have bought two pieces that I think we've all seen overall. What we've learned at the end of our sort of process to get ready for this Atlantic meeting was that our sweet spot is what we call social innovation at an inflection point. And what we found was, is every time we went back to someone we had helped and asked them sort of, how are we helpful and where were you at, we found that at any stage in, let's say, a life cycle of social innovation, that you hit some sort of point where you've got to go to the next step. And what we found that we were best at is helping people grapple with that next step overall. Innovation is not, you know, a point in time that is a better idea, but the constant innovating within that idea. And that our ability to come in, so when someone had asked sort of who we will work with, this is starting to become sort of our litmus test of, you know, are they a highly innovative organization, both in what they do and how they think, so that we can come and push them to get to that next step. And just to give you a little bit of a sense of our financials, so we're about a $3 million organization. We have, you know, part-time, full-time, and independents, you know, 30-plus staff working in the different areas overall. You know, a significant portion of our work is earned, but all those other initiatives that aren't in consulting are philanthropically driven. We are a nonprofit organization, and I think it was founded that way, both to keep the impact piece front and center, but also so that we could explore our vision in a way that made sure that we were dealing with impact overall. So, you know, we do get a fair amount of both individual and grants and things of that sort overall. This is just a stat to say that direct clients, because I should have said earlier that most of our consulting work is what we call third-party pay. So foundations pay us to work with their grantees. But we are getting, for example, the National Charter School is paying us directly. So I would say the root cause at this point when we gave this was at an inflection point overall. I think we are now acting on that inflection point overall. Before I tell you about where we're going, maybe what I'll do is stop there and see if you have questions about this overall and throw out anything. And some of your questions were quite challenging, so come at me because that's the best way to be. So as challenging as you want to be, go for it. But feel free to ask me anything about anything. Yeah?
This is not a challenging question, but I'm just curious, when do you expect for the social impact research to be available?
No, great question. So I didn't give you much detail about it. So, so the big challenge around that work is who's going to pay for it. And so what we found in a fairly significant amount, the person who's running for me was an MIT student of mine, by the way, literally almost 2 years ago, is that while we think there is a growing trend of donors, and of course foundations to some degree, who care about impact, they certainly don't care enough about impact to pay for research. So we think that the place where we might be able to find a business model is through what we call the gatekeepers. So the people that service the donors, so that's community foundations, United Ways, wealth advisors, family offices, people that serve them. What we found, oddly enough, those donors are coming to them and asking them questions that they don't know how to answer. So the Hewlett Foundation has funded us. They're the only national foundation in the country that's working on what some people will call either the social capital markets or the challenge around capital flow, to do a one-year subscription pilot that we're going to be launching in Massachusetts, where we will pick five gatekeeper organizations. And we will give them a set of services over that year that if they get value out of it, they'll start to pay as a subscribed service. So we will give them, we're going to start with the education sector, and we're going to start with the subsector of early ed in Massachusetts. We will give them a set of reports over time, over 1 year period. We're also going to do what we're calling philanthropic portfolio analysis. So is where they're giving matching where they want to give? So we would analyze, are people diversified in their stocks, or are they diversified in their giving overall? And then we're going to run a series of workshops, both for advisors on how to speak this way to their clients, as well as for individuals as well, themselves overall. And so we're sort of putting our money where our mouth is and seeing, you know, whether or not we're going to add any value. So this year is a big deal because we actually got the letter signed, so we're in the game. But if we do anything, it's a different story, but we're in the game.
What is the competitive landscape like for, you know, just like
consultants and tours off on this. I guess, are you guys, do you guys ever compete with like the Bridge family or like the McKinsey's and trying to get these social networks?
So I think, I don't know how others at the other firms, you know, sometimes I feel that I probably shouldn't say we're competing with a Bridge family or McKinsey because I think it has to be a particularly unique situation where we go up against them directly. We are, so first of all, let me just speak to the competitive landscape. I think there is, Rich Spam created the market. And what happened was, is what you had was you had a market that was polluted by sort of three, no offense, team engagements, alumni engagement, stuff like that, that was sort of in the nonprofit sector. And then you have really big projects for like a really big organization, you know, like United Way National or Habitat for United National. And they had budgets, you know, $50 million they could pay. And what Bridge Spam did was they said that followed by a foundation would pay that we could charge a large enough price to drive a business model, to put a team on it, to develop plans that were strategically focused as opposed to we did. Because where consulting was here was sort of like a fundraising consultant, a marketing consultant, something like that. No one was doing it from a strategic perspective overall. Bridge Spam's engagements, which have gone up now, are in the $250,000 to $350,000 range. Okay? Cause has slowly moved its way up, but we are a little less expensive. We have a lower team model. You know, we're generally in the 150 to 200K range overall. So now to go back. So the competitive landscape depends on what the organization really wants. Within the market that we're in right now, prior to the recession, I don't think there was a competitive landscape. I think there was a competition for really cool engagements, of which, you know, depending on who we had a relationship with the foundation, but whether it was Bridge Spam or anyone else, there was no work needed. And someone like Marner Institute, which is sort of in the same realm, you know, they've even decided they didn't want to hire a lot of people. They only want like three or six really cool engagements. I think things have changed, at least for us. And my guess is, although I haven't spoken to Jeff Braddock recently, I think with the recession, I think, you know, this being doled out at a time when growth is not as important as survival is making it a little bit more challenging overall. Does that answer your question?
You mentioned that root cause is essentially a collection of polyfunctions.
You should ask everyone who works with me that question. So I think the advantages of that, you know, I mean, I think the advantage of that we're certainly more money, quite honestly. And I don't know that, and so I think that it's allowed us to play in some areas that do fit back into the mission, but the vision, I should say, the mission. But besides giving me a sandbox, quite honestly, I'm not sure. You know, and I'm just being frank because you know, without giving you, you know, this other PowerPoint, when we started to do our planning process, we were lucky enough to bring in a consultant to work with us, and basically there were three choices that he put forth for us. So one was, we become this world-class consulting firm, right? So we're sort of on our way that we could probably do that. We might even turn it into a for-profit. The second choice was to continue to operate in which was essentially a holding company. right? At that time, you know, where does the Eastern Universe fit in? Where does social innovation, where do these all these fit in? Which is sort of, or the question, or the third one, which is to find synergy overall. And while, which you'll see, while we chose this, it's a bear of a challenge for us right now, you know, because we have people operating in their silos no matter how often we meet together. We also have sub-brands, a ton of them, which you can see. Root Cause, Social Innovation Forum has far greater brand equity in the city of Austin than Root Cause does, you know, overall within the donor community. We work so hard that it gives us significant amounts of money. They've never even heard of Root Cause. They didn't even know that, you know, we do consulting. So I think it's a great question. And so the disadvantages are we've got to sort of pull it all back in together overall. I do believe, though, and you will be the judge of this when I show you this, that if you're truly committed to the vision, that we came to the conclusion we owed ourselves to struggle with the synergy question overall. And now the challenge is can we get there overall.
Since you are committed to all of these initiatives, how do you allocate your time, and what does your day look like, and does it change depending
on your day? My primary time is allocated in four ways, I guess I would say. The first is, which I'd like to try to get out of, but it's pretty hard, which is I do lead a couple of projects still. And generally I'm leading ones that are probably the most at sort of the cutting edge of, I think, social innovation, and we wouldn't get them if I didn't say I lead them, which I'm happy to talk about them if you want. They're pretty interesting. The second is in both social impact research and public innovators, because they're in its earliest stages, and so they really need my level of thinking. So even though both of them have their own people who run them, as opposed to the Social Innovation Forum, which I think in the last 2 or 3 years I've probably worked 3% of my time on. We have someone who runs it, it's got a sustainable model, it's sort of driving it sort of way overall. And then most recently, which we didn't have to spend time on, but now I'm putting a lot of time into business development overall. I would say that those are pretty much my time. Yeah.
For social impact research, I assume that the incentive for the social organizations to give you access to the information and is so that if you get a good rating, they'll attract more investment. The original, what happens to those organizations that you find are not in good condition and give them a bad rating? Did you then offer them consultancy?
Is that your question on
here?
It's a very good question. Well, let me just tease it out, because really your question is, what you're absolutely right, is us going into this work could present a massive conflict of interest. Let me just be clear. I think rating is a little bit too strong. We're not putting out there, at least right now, to be a Moody's. In fact, I don't know how many people are on the site, but we do sort of see if there's a similarity in the private sector. There's probably a need for sort of a sector report, which looks at the overall landscape, what we call a benchmark report that can sort of put the sort of high performers against each other, and then an organizational report. We're being advised, because we're like way ahead of where this all could be, that we're probably going to stick with organizational reports, and then only if the foundation wants it will we drive a sector report right now. So we're probably going to shy in the early stages around what one might call a bad rating or good rating. Even so, our reports are not like you get an A or a B minus or something like that. It's more like, how do we look more sophisticated at what it means to be a high performer? With that said, I think we are trying to deliberately stay out of a field that we've had any experience, that we wind up that one of our clients was one of the ones that we might review. So we've done almost no work in early childhood. I mean, we could easily go into the aging field, because we've been doing a lot of work with the land for a long time. But we're trying to stay away from that, so at least we can stay away from that moment of conflict for as long as possible. I think when we hit that moment, I think we're going to have to figure that out and probably be a little bit more public about that overall. But there is a little bit of a business model out of it you pick up on that I'm not going to deny, because it's Gartner Group's business model, quite honestly, from the Gartner Group. And the reality is that if you drive through research, And there's needs that those organizations have, and we have the ability to consult with them. That's a great business model. So there's certainly something about that that we hope eventually comes about. And we are starting to move more and more into performance management system building for organizations.
You discussed the social impact and the logic chain earlier in your talk. And we were talking in class in the past couple weeks about how some organizations sometimes collapse that model and have something like, you know, outputs or even outcome represented as impact, especially when they go to donors and funders. So I was wondering, do you have intentions to measure your organization's social impact beyond, say, the client number or the funding raised, and you know, on the more on the ground sort of impacts that are created? And specifically, you know, the funding that Root Causes has raised, I was wondering, do you know how much of that is directly attributable to the marginal difference that your consulting provided over what would have otherwise been provided?
Both are great questions. I mean, so it's part of the bigger question, which you also have that question on here, which is sort of the biggest challenge, right, is, you know, the outcomes that you measure, how applicable they are to the work that we did overall. So in the presentation I just showed you, we did start to develop, which I actually deleted out of here, so I'm sorry. I could bring it up and be helpful to start to put a framework. You know what, maybe I will do it. I think you'll find it. So while I'm looking for it, so in the Atlantic presentation, you know, the stats I showed you were probably already out there. So we did deliberately start to figure out what a framework for impact might be overall. And we did it with one organization, which I can show you. We are now, that we've gone through this, what 2.0 would look like, are putting our own performance measurement in that's trying to be built on this new framework that we'll see in a moment, what those indicators would be and how we put that system in. I think the question around two places where, you know, who knows, certainly the money raised when it was directly where they used our model of write a business plan, and we have something we call the roadshow in our process, which is very similar to the private sector, where we say you should start raising money for this plan while we're planning. So by the end of it, we hope you can raise all the phase one, we go 3 to 6 months afterwards, so that you can focus on strategy as opposed to fundraising. We've had a fair amount of success with that, and I think, you know, the few organizations we ask, we're going to ask them to say that, you know, our planning process and that way of modeling is significantly impactful on that. We've had others that haven't used that overall. I also think that the 86% we implement has told us about how incredibly valuable it is. I think we have extreme high amounts of retention where a large percentage of the people, if they have the money, we hire us to help them follow along. The question of whether or not both they make any impact on whether we have any impact on the impact they make, you know, that's $1 million. You know what? I did not put it on, so I can't assure you. But we try to look at things like, you know, how well is the leadership developed? How well have they hit the benchmarks on the business plan, social impact wise and output wise, and so on and so forth. I mean, I think it's a slippery slope, and so I want to instead give you my opinion on measurement, which I think is a more healthy way for us to look at measurement right now. And it has to do with this feedback loop piece. So I think that our change work has gotten sort of crazy on outputs and outcomes. And I think what we haven't focused on is an ability for the organization to measure and adjust. And we just have to get good at figuring out who does that and keep investing in them if they can reward them, as opposed to, because so many different variables are involved with whether or not, you know, we can get a kid to be better or not. And what we should really start to understand is who are the organizations that are actually really trying to be high performers and are willing to, if they said that they were going to reach 500 kids, and of those 500 kids, 70% of them increased their reading literacy. And instead, they only reached 350, and it was 65%. But they had the systems in place, and they could tell you why. and they have the systems in place to change. I can tell you from my experience that that is a real orientation right now. And so I'd like to reward them for that point, as opposed to get caught up with whether this works or that works right now, as opposed to the organizations that are sort of driving towards the course correction feedback. That's just when we look at 2.0, you'll get an idea of the framework, and I can come back and talk to you about how we hope to measure some more specifics. All right.
So you, in your paper, you talk a lot about sort of how the organization tries to work with the government, and your goal to sort of spread this model across the country. So have you, how do you go about doing that? Do you start locally within neighborhoods or cities, or do you go like to
DC
and kind of
Yeah. So there was a question someone asked about is it people or teams, someone said. I don't know. Someone said, you know, do you think it's, I think you said Bill Drayton was here, and you know, when you think about change, do you focus on is the person more important or is the team more important? While I think, you know, it's all about the people, I'm interested in models. And the reason why I'm interested in models is that in the private sector, everyone wants a monopoly. So you have a great business and you want to own your niche in that market for as long as you can and drive profitability and rule the world. And I believe it's the exact opposite in the work that we're doing, is that great innovative models or great ways to adjust models are known. How do we get better at spreading those models in any particular way? So the question then became, if that's true, and government is sort of the driver of that the reason why government to me now has become sort of, I have to say to some level, without the resources to put toward it, you know, where I think the future for root cause is because literally solving society's problems that are systemic today, they have access to all the systems, they make all the laws, they provide the majority of the funding, and they actually do a significant amount of direct service work. And I think that the nonprofit sector, particularly the social entrepreneurship movement, sort of just has been sleeping at the wheel on this fact, which is a fact. We did some work in out-of-school time work, which has sort of been this bubbling up fragmented industry of out-of-school time work that's bubbling up all across. And, completely forgetting about the fact that there's this public education system that has the kids in the school from 9 to 3 every day, for example. So the question then becomes, to now come to your question, is so how do you do that overall? Let me just start with our biggest sort of fundamental premise that may not fly. But we think the most important thing is we have to start to highlight what we think is a new look of a different government leader. Overall, we're calling this public innovator. Maybe we'll successfully brand this term or not. But we think that this leader should begin to embrace social innovation and entrepreneurship so they can accelerate those problems that if you look back to our vision statement. And they can be in any parts of government. They can be elected officials, government leaders who provide resources for direct service or policymaker. And as you saw in the paper, that there are these roles that they can work on overall. So how are we doing that? So we have three very deliberate strategies that are in early stages. And if anyone knows a funder who wants to drive this funding, wasn't successful with the Skoll Foundation, that would be great. Number one is we're trying to make publicinnovators.org, I think, tricky.com, a information resource hub. So if you go on there, you'll see a map, and that map has places in cities and states where there's activities going on like this that are government-driven. You can also go and you can download reports and articles and things like that, and we hope that government leaders start to go there and know the go-to source without us having to do it. Number two is we hope to highlight government leaders. So in 2 weeks at the Social Enterprise Alliance Summit, we're officially giving the first ever public innovator award to the Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana, who in early 2006 started the first ever Office of Social Entrepreneurship in the state. So start to raise the profile of different types of people, and we hope to start to write these public innovator profiles overall. And then the third is, which is where we hope someday there's maybe a business model here if we can't find philanthropy, is we are now consulting the government. So we wrote the business plan for the Office of Social Entrepreneurship of Louisiana. We're now doing the first ever statewide study in the state of Texas on what are the barriers to advancing social innovation within the state of Texas overall, which will be part of a governor's commission overall. So just to throw those three out there. So the first is an information hub. The second is highlight the leaders. And the third is build at the city and state level overall. We have advocated for the federal level. Not many people know, but there's two pretty important things that have happened in the last 6 weeks at the federal level. One is that Obama has quietly opened up an Office of Social Innovation in the White House. I think what it's supposed to do is not clear yet, although it has some buckets of what they say it will do. And second, there was some important legislation that was passed called the Serve America Act. And while that act is like 90% about increasing volunteerism, it has a social innovation fund in it. So it would be the first ever sort of innovation fund out of government, sort of with government dollars, which is also pretty interesting. So we've been advocating that any new federal programming always has a city and state-based strategy, and that we are sort of the link that can help them do that. I think I'll take one more, and then I'll make sure I give you 2.0, and then we can get some other questions.
This is a related question. One of the important qualities of any innovator, but particularly a social innovator that we've identified is a propensity to take risks and sort of do unconventional things. And I can't think of too many more people more risk averse than the incumbent American politician. How do you sort of plan to combat that? How do you plan to confront the fact that social innovation might not, at best won't get people any votes, and at worst could, be controversial enough to lose themselves?
I think that was what was in here as well. I think that is probably the biggest hurdle to this right now. So let me give two answers to that. The one answer is that I think if we understand that large businesses do well by allocating a small percentage of the budget to R&D and innovation, drives success. So it's not that there's a complete reinvention of government actually going on here. There's more an embracing of understanding the tenets around social innovation and entrepreneurship and how it can help government do a better job. So I think the more we're careful about that this is not the answer, but something that sort of has been missing, I think the better off that we can be. The fact that there's something called SBIR grants, if you've heard of them, which are these allocation in every federal agency has the allocation of dollars to do basically the equivalent of free loans to businesses at different levels, right? So you can get like a $250,000, never have to pay it back, start a business. You can get to the next level, you get like $3 million and then $5 million. And every government agency has an allocation of that, right? Think about charter schools. All the charter school is a 1-3% reallocation of the education budget, and look at sort of what it's driven overall, right? So if you imagine you took any social issue and just tried the same thing, maybe you could just drive some different competitive behavior that might be actually worthwhile in some way, but not to break down all the systems, at least that's not my perspective. With that said, if you get a chance, on our website is the, I think it's only the podcast. When the Aspen paper came out, we had a panel. And that panel had on it a social entrepreneur named Kathy Foy, that independent transportation network woman, someone from American Enterprise Institute on the right, the Center for American Progress on the left. In fact, this woman, Michelle Joel, is now in the Office of Social Innovation, and a lieutenant governor. And towards the end, he answered this. And so if you just sort of fast forward to get to that part. it's hard, and he's taking a big risk. There's no doubt about it. I think Mayor Fenty, if you know much about the mayor of D.C., has got a similar sort of attitude. Cory Booker has a similar attitude. And the question is there a unique politician that's emerging? Obama, I think, to a certain degree, perhaps a similar attitude. Do you have the political savviness to know how to push it far enough without losing re-election? That's going to be sort of the question that I think the politicians that are thinking this way are going to ask themselves overall. But I think it's a really, really good question. And I'll just say one more thing about the invest and reinvest piece, which is where this government piece of where the whole thing falls apart. I believe there should be some rule that says if you're an elected official and your predecessor started something that measurably is doing well, or you start something and you set up clear benchmarks, if a new elected person comes in, you can't get rid of them. Because that in of itself actually is what I actually believe is the fundamental biggest barrier right now. You know, if you have this massive education experiment going on in New York City with Bloomberg and Klein, a new mayor can completely dismantle it in a heartbeat. The Office of Social Entrepreneurship in Louisiana, which is begging to try to get any kind of resources right now, Lieutenant Governor decides to run for mayor, which she did and lost by a few thousand votes in New Orleans. Again, can he bring that with him? Maybe, maybe not. If he doesn't, Republican governor, probably gone like right at that. And that is probably, I think, the biggest sort of challenges right now, is how do you sustain this kind of thinking?
Today, we are very fortunate to have Andrew Walk with us. Andrew, who seems, from our conversation at lunch, and if you read his bio, to have touched this whole area of, as we were talking about at lunch, social innovation in a bunch of different ways, not only clearly through education and introducing very early on courses in this field, but also in terms of interacting with government and trying to, on a larger macro-social level, begin to talk with people about how do we set a stage, how do we create an environment that is more conducive to social enterprise, and what are the sort of factors or conditions or things that we want to be putting in place as a society in order to foster more social innovation, in order to foster the creation, the emergence of these sorts of organizations. So Andrew's going to talk a little bit today about root cause, and then I think talk about a little bit of social enterprise in general, and then open it up to your questions. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, and I want good questions today.
Hi, everyone. How are you all?
You can talk.
Maybe a little louder. Hi, everyone. How are you all today?
Good.
Let me tell you how I'm going to frame what this is. I started a business that was this multi-restaurant delivery service in Connecticut, and I started to recognize that this business that was employing people had this amazing opportunity to create some real change. And it was that point that I started to think that those two worlds, my father's and my grandfather's, were really driving me towards how do those two worlds come together in some particular way. And that there was the passion for social change and creating impact and changing people's lives with some of the rigor around business, and not because business was actually had all the answers, but that we as a society, because of how we had valued business, had really learned how to scale certain types of services and products that people wanted because they were willing to pay money for it. And so that drove investment in business schools, it drove investment in education for business people, executive ed, professional development, so on and so forth. So a lot of the sort of money that went into business sort of drive the whole understanding of how businesses could thrive overall. And those two worlds were really coming together to me as I was working in this business. I did a couple of things at that time that I found to be interesting to me. It started while I had this business, a mortgage program where anyone who was in the business actually, that we would help them to get into a place like that. He also founded the School of Public Health at Carnegie Mellon. And was extremely active in bringing about a lot of innovations in bringing arts and culture to Pittsburgh, which both drove new businesses and citizens there as well as kept a certain citizen base there. And it was his sort of drive for public service that was a pretty unique impact on my life and watching, speaking to him before he died about his work. My father was a three-decade successful Wall Street executive. He was at Bear Stearns, which no longer exists. He wasn't there when all of the fallout happened overall. But he was certainly a maverick in business. He was highly innovative in what perhaps some people call the drive for some of our problems around derivatives. But in the very early stages where there were no derivatives, for those of you know, but just option trading, he was highly innovative in that overall. He went to HBS and had a very successful career. And the third piece is that I was a for-profit entrepreneur. And it was during that time where I had started, based on that meeting, gave us a planning grant to sort of put our own business planning process on ourselves. And I'm going to share with you what emerged is what we call Root Cause 2.0, which is sort of where we're now going. A couple of you talked about theory of change, so it's in our model of theory of change overall, so it gives you a sense of where we're going. Certainly not where we're at, but where our future is. I'll hope to try to put that out to you with some time to ask some questions as well, and I'll try to monitor it overall. So that's how I think we're going to set things up. So let me just briefly tell you, just personally and professionally, just a little bit about myself, and we'll stop and just see if anyone has any questions related to those particularly. On the personal side, there were sort of three things that I think are pretty important that I sort of have thought about as I've thought about my drive for this work. The first was my grandfather was a councilman. He was a councilman in Pittsburgh for like 25 plus years. And he was extremely innovative in the way that he brought a variety of different changes to that city. He was the first founder of smog control in the United States, practicing that in Pittsburgh. It sort of makes sense, right? Steel, things like that. So you can sort of see the impacts of that happening. I have to say, I don't know if you knew, but I got this list of questions that you all came up with. And if I answered all these, I'd probably be here for like 10 hours. But I was incredibly amazed at how thoughtful they were. So I think I'm going to frame today, knowing that we have till 2:30, is I'm going to tell you just very briefly about how I came into this work, so you get just some sort of sense from a personal and professional perspective what drove me to this point. I'm going to share with you a PowerPoint presentation that I gave to Atlantic Philanthropy's program officers in the U.S. Aging and Disadvantaged Youth Area, January of 2009, I should say nine, by the way. But this presentation, or a portion of it, was given in January of 2009. Is that right? 2008, let me take that back, 2008, which was sort of where Root Cause was at that point in time. I think after that, that'll give you an idea of some of the things you brought up, like what is our business model, how do our different units operate, things like that. And then I'm going to open up the questions and let you sort of drive the dialogue for a little while. And then I'm going to share with you Atlantic that